April was awful. You know, on top of everything else that's already happened this year, you just had to hit me with a bad reading month. I hope you're happy, world. I hope that you have just let loose all your hatred on me. And I hope everything gets better in May, because this month was awful. Like, not awful enough to make me want to rant about stuff. Certainly not a 5-star. No, I got like the 2 and 3 stars. The books that just make me feel, what's the word, ugh. Not angry, just sadly indifferent. It makes me feel like a pile of mush. That's what I'm thinking of. Reading honestly felt like such a chore this month, and I know exactly who to blame. All of these books, 3 DNFs, 3 2-stars, 1 3-star, and 1 3.5-stars. And that 3.5-stars actually wasn't even that good either. So if you're here for some happy sunshine, not today, no. This is just gonna be me imagining myself hitting these books with a bat. Let's start with my DNFs. A popular YA thriller you may have heard of, We Were Liars by E. Lockhartt. We Were Liars revolves around this very rich family that vacations every summer at this fancy schmancy island. That's like a little tiny island, but it has like 3 separate manors that each like main family stays at. You see how I'm kind of reading the summary off of the jacket? It's because I don't even remember barely what happened in this book. I remember enough to be like, wow, what a waste. A beautiful and distinguished family, a private island, a brilliant damaged girl, a passionate political boy, a group of 4 friends, the Liars, whose friendship turns destructive, a revolution, an accident, a secret, lies upon lies, true love, the truth. Read it, and if anyone asks you how it ends, just lie. So our main character is a gal named Candace. She doesn't want for nothing. She has a very opulent lifestyle. Actually, she does want for one thing, the love of one particular boy who vacations with them whenever her family goes out to their private island. Candace, I wish I could tell you a personality trait, but she has none. Except one, which isn't a trait, it's a characteristic. She got a hard hit to the head, which made her forget a specific summer she spent at the island. Because of her injury, she has crippling migraines, her mom refuses to let her go back to the island, the scene of the accident, she can't get in contact with any of her friends, she's staying at home with her dad, vacationing with her dad. Basically, the island is a no-no. Talking about the island is a no-no. But finally, she gets her mom to take her back to the island. She reunites with her friends, her cousins, her lover boy. And at least to the 100 pages I read to, it is chiefly just these friends hanging out on their fancy schmancy island eating artichokes. I DNF'd it, like I said, at 100 pages because, one, the writing style was weird. It was like super bloody, okay? So very early on in the chapter, just to give you guys an example, I got something in my eye, hold on. We see the scene of Candace's father leaving her and her mother. They're on the front yard, they're saying their goodbyes, he's getting into the car, you know, he's opening the door, he's getting in, then he turns around and shoots her. Her blood is flowing into the lawn. Oh, no, wait. The blood's metaphorical. It's sadness that she feels pouring out into the yard, but it's written like she actually got shot. And I'm just like, wait, what? So that's a little weird, like, sad. Really, any kind of, like, strong emotions is related to, like, an injury. Not even related, it's represented, it is written as an actual injury. There is a scene where Candace says that she has bloody wrist, and this guy that she likes, it writes that this guy bandaged her bloody wrist for her, and I'm like, okay, is this the metaphorical bloody wrist? Or is this an actual, did you cut yourself bloody wrist? The writing style was not that great. Also, we get introduced to Candace, the guy she likes, 2 other friends who are really bland, like the corny goofball guy who's also like a jock, the sort of like cheerleader, best friend, pal, chatty girl, side characters I don't care about at all. I don't care about anyone in this book because we have this massive family, the Sinclairs, and they're literally dumped on top of us in like the first couple of pages. Like we get introduced to them, that person, and I'm like, so many names, and it just sort of blurs together and I don't know who's who. Also, Candace is talking about how she wants to like really get to know her cousins, her friends better, but she admits that she never talks to them except during the summer vacation. So we don't get to talk to them except during the summer vacation. So I'm not attached to anyone. It was literally just 100 pages of me not caring and I wanted to play Pokemon and I DNF'd it. And also, I guess the twist. So I'm gonna put my spoiler tag over here. And like, I was reading it, y'all. I was like, right up to the accident, which is like super early in the book. Let's see, something happened. We can't remember that accident, but then we see her like taking her clothes off, going to the ocean, probably trying to drown herself. Then she hits her head or something, or like enough oxygen loss, air loss to hurt her brain. And so it's at this point with this almost lethal injury, I'm like, she's a ghost, isn't she? But then no, that theory was disproven because the mom is talking to the Candace, like she's alive. Candace is interacting with her father like she's alive, so she's not the ghost. And I'm like, I know for sure someone is dead, and there's a ghost somewhere in this story. I didn't care enough to like stick to it, close the book, looked up the spoilers, they're all ghosts, except Candace. I'm like, knew it. Okay, next book. My next one is a temporary DNF, Once Upon a River. Temporary because it's a really rich, flowery writing style, which I love when it's done correctly. And my favorite thing about the book, I got like, what, 200 pages into it? It had a way of making even the side characters seem like super important. We got to know everybody, everybody had a backstory, everyone was interesting. There were some funny laugh out loud moments for me. I'll tell you about one later. This is primarily a story about this inn. It's called the Swan Inn. That's on the riverbanks. Everybody in this village, they usually come to the Swan Inn to hear stories be told. But one night, this man, beat up, bloody face, like he just got shot in the head with a cannonball. He staggers into the inn. He's carrying this dead girl on his back. He collapses. They tend to his injuries. They put the girl in like basically the cooler because, oh my gosh, she's dead. But no, she's not dead. She wakes up. And so while the guy's unconscious, they're trying to figure out who is this girl, but she isn't talking. And then these three other characters, each with their own families, like say, oh my gosh, she looks like the daughter I lost. Same thing. This guy over here, she looks like the daughter I lost. Other guy, she looks like the daughter I lost like 2 months ago. So three families have a claim on this girl. And it's just up to them to figure out the girl's identity. And she's not telling anyone. Like I said, temporary DNF. I do want to get back into it one day, but unlike An Enchantment of Ravens, which had a very pretty writing style, this one was like a little too info dumpy. Not like exposition info dumpy. It's more like, oh my gosh, we live upon this amazing river. Let me tell you 100 facts about this river. I don't care about landscape facts. Unless you have built a colony atop the mossy back of a dragon, I don't want to know about your river. It was funny though, there was a scene where like the guy, he carries the girl into the inn, he collapses and they think the girl's dead, so they're focusing on the guy. And so all these farmers are like leaning over him, and one farmer's like, you know who this looks like? Old Ben, who lives down in the shack by the river. And some other farmer's like, Howie, old Ben's literally right next to you. Ben, how you doing? I thought that was funny. But in its way, which is a good way of, you know, making every character seem important, that way we can have like more of a mystery of like who this girl belongs to, really, because we have like a wider pool of people we actually care about to choose from. But there was just a lot of talking about who this person is and who that person is, and it's basically the event where the girl is found at the inn is the beginning. Then part two is literally on hold as we explain the backstories of the three families who lost their girl. And yeah, crucial to the story, but it's like a blockade. It just, here's the flow of the book, here's part two. Now you have to navigate around it to get back to the flow of the story. And like the thing that just said, I need to take a break from it for now, is I had to take a break from reading, put my bookmark in, closed the book, went away, came back to it, and I had absolutely no idea whose POV we were in. Didn't know what we were doing, didn't know where we were at, didn't know what we were looking for. I just felt like so confused, like I couldn't remember anything because there was just so much wordiness instead of like doingness, you get me? So I think I just need to be in a more attentive mindset to enjoy this book. Oh, and also, there's a little tag right here because I've realized something about me. I like changelings, okay? Murphy Napier, my favorite booktuber. She loves sirens. That's like her favorite mythical creature. And I love dragons, but I also love like the whole legends of changelings. And there's a character in this book, the son of the innkeepers, and they think he's a changeling. And I'm like, oh my gosh, that is so cool. I haven't gotten to read about a changeling yet. I would really like to, but no. The doctor comes in and she's like, oh, he's not a changeling. He just has a big tongue. And I'm like, you just killed the magic. Couldn't you leave it up to, like, to our interpretation to decide if he's a changeling or not? That would have been magical. So missed opportunity there for having a changeling in your book. But another time. This next book is heckin' weird, okay? I was determined to finish this book just so I can put it on my 2020 best worst books of all time list. I couldn't finish it. I'm going to have to one day so I can justify putting it on the list. But right now, no. The Devil Walks in Mattingly. They better be glad I ain't walking in Mattingly. I would hit all of them in the face. Good news, I'm only out $2 for this book. I don't know, I was just browsing the store one day in the bargain section. I'm like, ooh, the devil? That sounds like a cool villain. Look at those scary looking moths. They're illuminated. Supernatural going on here? What? Wasn't that impressed by the back of the book. It's a simple small town secret. Three friends got involved in some kid's suicide or accident, but no, it's a murder. We gotta find out who murdered the person. It's the obvious one, by the way. And one thing I did not know is written on the back of here, it says Christian fiction. So if you don't like Christian fiction, not the book for you. However, I like Jesus and I like Christian fiction, so I will read it. This had nothing to do with Jesus. This book, I tried reading it before. I stopped at page 4 because the writing style is so grandiose. And yet, even as I hold my name and station in the highest regard, that is not why I dare enter this wood and strike east and north for the grove. I come to this place of darkness because it is where the light of heaven once touched. I come here for the ones who were saved on a night long ago and for the ones lost. I come because heaven is not without the past. Change may come beyond this wide span of gnarled trees and gray soil, but the hollow clings to its past and will not yield to the passing of time. It endures. To face this blackness is to find yourself at once drawn and repulsed, and here more than anywhere else I understand that I am not alone. It's just a really stiff, too prosy writing style. It's puffy. Puffy is a good word. It is more describing the things around you than what's going on inside you. I want that internalness, not linking every blade of grass to the ultimate grand scheme of the universe or something like that. We get introduced to some of the blandest, worst characters ever. Our sheriff, who is like a coward, and like a cowardly sheriff like Barney Fife could be something amazing. No, this guy just sits around and throws his tomahawk at trees all day. His wife, who could be interesting trying to make up for that accident that happened way back when by giving gifts to the poor and stuff. No, she's more like a behind-the-scenes person who just pops up to give motivational advice every now and then. The son, who's like, let's say 6, he talks like he's 15. And this book, it is super southern. I mean, listen to me. I am very southern, but I could hardly understand anything they were saying. Like, you know how J.K. Rowling wrote for Hagrid and would just like smush two words together, put an apostrophe in there, change there to der, multiply that by 5. So hard to read because of all the abbreviations, the puffy writing style, bad characters. Oh my gosh. There is this girl named Lucy in this book, and she's our skeptic to all the weird supernatural going-ons in this place. She's gross. I mean, there is just one scene of her drooling. That was nasty. Like, it had one good plot. The ghost of the man who got killed in the accident, suicide, murder, / whatever it is. Like, he would be haunting the sheriff in his dreams and he'd tell him, I'm coming for you, I'm coming for you. He only popped up a few times. And that was literally the only thing keeping me in his book because I wanted a nice revenge ghost haunting story. It could not keep my attention. I wanted to finish it, but I couldn't, giving more weight to my theory that the longer the summary is, the worse the book is, has not let me down once. And now let's get to the books I actually finished. They're still disappointing. One is a highly hyped thriller. I love thrillers. I'm particularly wounded by this. Girl on the Train. I predicted it. And that's not an accomplishment. It's super easy. We also get, okay, I love unlikable characters. I love a villain. I love Gray. However, I ain't gonna root for cheaters. We have a cast of three leading ladies. One is Rachel, the blubbering alcoholic. Like, I think that trope of an alcoholic narrator came from this lady. I'm not exactly sure, but I feel like it's right. And that makes her, because she blacks out a lot, a very unreliable narrator, which could be good, but it's more like infuriating in this book. Because she got a nasty divorce from her husband who was cheating on her with our other main character, Anne. I'll just call her Anne. So all she does is drinks, and she rides the bus.
It's literally called Girl on the Train. Is she gonna be riding a bus? No, you had one job. Girl on the Train.
And she rides the bus to where she used to work every day to trick her roommate into thinking she's going to work when she actually lost her job because she drinks and she drinks. And that's literally all she does in the book besides looking out of a window, writing notes, crying, throwing up, and drinking. She's not interesting. I'm not really rooting for her. I was like meh throughout the whole book. Anne is our second woman. Other woman? Mistress. Got Rachel's ex-husband Tom to cheat on her, and she doesn't feel guilty. She knew he was married, so am I her fan? No. And our other girl is Megan. She's cheating too. I don't like these women at all. Our main character, Rachel, the main character, she sees a particular accident while she's riding on that train, and it's only like a brief little shot of what she saw, and it only lasted a little snippet, but then she decides she wants to like weasel her way into this investigation. She doesn't help at all. She just gets in the way. The writing style was nice. I could see everything. It was a super short book. I read it in 2 days. But thrillers should thrill me. Like, of course I wanted to know how it ended, how this like little crime she saw in the window ended. But other than that, I didn't feel like suspense. I didn't feel like I was being watched. I didn't feel hyped up to like root for our character. I just felt like get to the end so I'll just know for sure what happened. And I predicted it. I actually had many theories. I had a little notebook and like I kept scratching them out as I got through the list until I only had like one left and it was right. There's not a giant cast of characters in this one. And you have three suspects. You have the really, really obvious one who is obviously not the perpetrator because he's too obvious. Then you have the red herring who's too nice. So you're thinking, it's him. Then you have the obvious right suspect who did it. And yeah, just felt nothing throughout the whole book, basically. Oh, and then you have like this, I'm gonna call it like a side quest to find out who this redheaded man is. Not worth the time to write him in. He led to nothing. So yeah, 2 stars. And guys, I am so sorry. I saw all the comments saying that you loved it and that you were excited to hear my thoughts on it. My best friend, my first subscriber, she's been begging me to read this book. Well, I'm going to give her this book now because I don't want it anymore. 2 stars. The Night Circus by Erin Morgenstern. Beautiful cover. Good. I'm gonna read you the back to show you exactly how much you let me down. The circus arrives without warning. No announcements preceded. It is simply there. When yesterday, it was not. Within the black and white striped canvas tents is an utterly unique experience full of breathtaking amazements. It is called Le Cirque des Reves, and it is only open at night. But behind the scenes, a fierce competition is underway. A duel between two young magicians, Celia and Marco, who have been trained since childhood expressly for this purpose by their mercurial instructors. Unbeknownst to them, this is a game in which only one can be left standing. Amidst the high stakes, Celia and Marco soon tumble headfirst into love, setting off a domino effect of dangerous consequences and leaving the lives of everyone from the performers to the patrons hanging in the balance. First off, Celia and Marco soon tumble headfirst into love. That's a spoiler. You shouldn't have put that in the summary. That could have been like an enemies to lover thing if you just would have hush-hushed about it. But now we know it's gonna happen, so there's no suspense there. So, my friend marketed this book to me as like a very atmospheric, magical circus adventure. And I like atmosphere. I was ready for it. What I was really excited for was the duel. I wanted these people to throw knives at each other. I wanted someone to end up in like a lion tamer's pit. I wanted some circusy high action, okay? Walking a tightrope made out of barbed wire, stuff like that. High stakes duel. This book was about who could build the best attraction. It's a book about magical construction, not magical duels. And yeah, it was pretty what they made, but I wanted a duel. I wanted bloody noses, broken knuckles, torn skin, and just magic wands shooting off at one another. Not what I got. But is it my fault for having the wrong expectations? Did I unfairly rate this book a 2? I did not. My main beef with the book was the writing style, and I know why. Two reasons why. First off, it ends in the way I hate the most. It's not a spoiler how it ends. It's basically an ending where you realize some other character is narrating the story, repeating the first line of the book for the last line. I hate that. I've read like, what, 3 books that did that? And I'm like, wow, I feel nothing. Now I just feel like I'm caught in some sort of time loop. So yeah, we are basically reading some other secondhand person's narration, and that's why the writing style is so impersonal. Like, it literally feels like the characters are in this little box and we're just like looking down on them. We're not in the box. We're not. I can't remember a time we were like in their heads, feeling what they were feeling, hearing what they were thinking. No, we were only seeing their actions, and it was so impersonal. I didn't get attached to any characters. None. I cared nothing for them. But, and there was so much magic in the world, and I was interested in that. But, okay, it gets away with this because of something it said, but nothing was explained. And that makes me mad, because I wanted to get more into the magic system. But then, like, one of the characters says, and I'm paraphrasing, people always treat magic like it's this super rare thing. No, it's not rare. It's everywhere. It's just the people who can use it are rare. So, okay, so magic isn't something you create. It's something all around us, and it's always there. Just few people can actually touch it, and that's what makes it seem rare. That's cool. I get that. But we didn't, like, get any explanation on how these rare individuals are able to touch that magic. We don't know how Celia is able to make stuff explode besides her emotions, which is, like, a big cop-out. Oh, Grisha Trilogy did that already. And we don't know how Marco is able to make magic out of the runes and writing he does. Also, what's up with Bailey? That guy literally just showed up out of nowhere. All he does is walk around, look at the exhibits, and suddenly he gets, like, so many fabulous things happening to him. He just felt like he was stuck in there just so there could be a conclusion. I didn't like, what happened to Celia and Marco towards the end and how that does involve Bailey, but I still don't like Bailey because he's just a figurehead, basically a mannequin, suited to the purpose to tie the results together. Actually, let me find my phone real quick. I wrote to my friend why I didn't like this book. Okay, I told my friend I finished the Night Circus. She said, ooh, thoughts. And I said, I rate based on 5 things. 5 stars, 5 things. Writing style, characters, plot, uniqueness, rereadability. I gave it 2 stars. It had the uniqueness, and it had a pretty writing style except for like the whole impersonal thing that I don't like. I think the premise is unique, but the whole promise of a competition between the 2 MCs was very bland, very distant, and aloof. More concerned with whimsy and atmosphere than the competition. Also, the writing style was very impersonal, so I didn't get attached to any characters, and I have no urge to reread it. So yeah, that sums it up nicely. And I'm sorry that I didn't like a book so many of you guys did like. I am interested in her other book, The Starless Sea, and I'm going to give that a try. Okay, and our next book is The Darling of BookTube, Because You Love to Hate Me. 2 stars. I did not know what this book was when I bought it. I thought it was a booktuber and an author teaming up to write separate prompts. Like, one of these prompts is a young Moriarty. So I thought Bob the author would write his own Moriarty story, and Sally the booktuber would write her Moriarty story. No, the booktubers come up with a prompt, and then the author writes it. Not bad, this could be interesting, but it's a short story, it's an anthology, I guess. So it's a mixed bag. Most of these weren't good. 3 of them were very good. And I'll give you like a little individual summary of each story, but chiefly all my complaints were, for the bad ones at least, that they're short stories, you can't go through a lot of character growth, and this is Because You Love to Hate Me. It's all about villains, so we're either already in a villainous person's point of view, or we're in just a really mean person's point of view, or we're in a good person who turns into an evil person. In that last case, it's done so suddenly it's not done well. So yeah, too short, no character development, that makes sense. That's chiefly my complaints for the ones I didn't like. So I'm gonna go through short summary of all the short stories. Okay, by Renee Audier, The Blood of Emiriv. This is a story about an evil son who wants to be like his evil grandmother who got murdered in their kingdom for being evil. Now his mother is like a symbol of good. He's like, no, I want to be evil like her. Happened too quickly, didn't get attached to any characters. And all these stories end with like a little note from the booktuber that has nothing to do with anything except why they chose this prompt, so I didn't read it. All except Christine Riccio, who wrote Again But Better. Hers was okay. It was somewhat original. The story Jack by Amerie. I didn't read this one because I don't care anything for about Jack and the Beanstalk. So I skipped it. Wynn and Art and Lance, a modern retelling of the Lancelot author, King of the Round Table thing. Boring is a bunch of text messages exchanging. Didn't care. Shirley and Jim, sort of like a gender bin on Sherlock Holmes, except she's Shirley Holmes now and Jim Moriarty is still Jim Moriarty. How they met, sort of fell in love, and he betrayed her, obviously. I gave it a 3, it was good, but like, the obvious, like, ooh, I'm a villain thing is so obvious. The Blessing of Little Wants by Sarah Innie. This had the potential of being like a cool world-building thing, where like, we're in this head of a young witch, and this government is like suppressing the magic users because it's only a finite source of magic. So the more magic users, the less magic to go around. So they're knocking out all the witches so they can have more power. That's interesting. But then we had like a sudden hero to villain turn that made no sense really. So 2 stars. The Sea Witch by Marissa Meyer. This is Ursula, you know, the sea witch from The Little Mermaid. And what would happen if she were in Ariel's position, where she had to exchange her fin for legs. Legs that feel like she's walking on glass. So she can go into the surface world and talk to the man she loved. What would happen if she was in her shoes? It was very interesting. I liked it. Marissa Meyer is a good retelling author. 5 stars. Beautiful Venom by Cindy Pond. A Medusa retelling. You know Medusa? She's set in ancient Greece. This one is set in like ancient China. It was interesting, but still kind of meh. Especially the ending, so 3 stars. Death Nail by Victoria Schwab. 5 stars. This is a story about Death waking up at the bottom of a well and he has this urge to like Grim Reaper someone. And this is him following that person around and kind of re-experiencing what life feels like. Marigold by Samantha Shannon. I don't remember this one at all. Ah, I know now. It is a fae story. Like, there's England and then there's the forest where the fae lives. You got a Queen Fairy and Queen Elizabeth. Some injustice is done and the queen demands the life or the servitude of one of the human women. She chooses Marigold. She goes off into the forest and her lover and her brother go out to rescue her. 2 stars. 1 star is for the cool fairies that were in it. Ended again too abruptly and I didn't care about Marigold really. Her background wasn't explained enough and her personality not deep enough. You, It's All About You by Adam Silvera. My favorite one. This one's really good. This is about a masked drug lord who goes into the underbelly of her city to sell her wares and kicking butt and taking names at the same time. And it's told in second person. So you are walking down the chilly night road. You feel the breeze tickle your shins. I love that writing style. Julian Breaks Every Rule. I give this one 4 stars. It's by Andrew Smith. We're in a young psychopath's point of view where he can kind of like wish when people die. Like, oh, I wish you'll die. They'll die in the most weirdest ways. But it kind of like tumbleweeded to a halt at the end and have a spectacular ending. Indigo and Shade by April Guinevere Tagolik. This is a Gaston retelling from Beauty and the Beast. And Gaston was so obviously the narcissistic mean guy, but not done well enough to think he's not narcissistic, but just obviously I'm a Chad narcissistic. So 2 stars. And then the last one, Sarah, which is Ares spelled backwards by Nicola Yoon, a gender bend of a god of war, Ares. The story about a young girl named Sarah growing up and she's crazy, but ending wasn't that satisfactory, so 2 stars. And yeah, that's it. I only like 3 of the stories, so do I recommend you buy it for those 3 stories? They're pretty good, but that's up to you. I got this for $4, so I'm gonna keep it. Just for those 3 stories. And finally, we're getting up to the 3 stars. This one's a disappointment to me. because for half the book, it was 5 stars. Then it got weird. The Goldfish by Goldfish! I did it again! The Goldfinch by Donna Tartt. Theo Decker, a 13-year-old New Yorker, miraculously survives an accident that kills his mother. Abandoned by his father, Theo is taken in by a wealthy Park Avenue family. He is bewildered by his strange new home and tormented by his longing for his mother. Clings to the one thing that reminds him of her, a small, mysteriously captivating painting that has come into his possession. As an adult, Theo moves easily between the antique stores where he works, the drawing rooms of the rich, and the underworld of art. He is alienated, unmoored, and in love, and drawn inexorably by the power of that painting into a narrow, dangerous circle. Donna Tartt, she's able to use a bunch of words and not confuse you. I really like that. I was really hooked in. I loved Theo, our main character. I felt him. I felt what he was going through, and I just really loved him. The poor dude went through so much. He survived basically a terrorist attack, and this is basically the longest contemporary to ever live. We are just living this poor boy's life, and there I was very invested. I loved Theo. There were times where he went through some stuff, and I was like, no, no! I said stuff out loud. I was invested. I loved him. I liked the family he was staying with, the rich family. I loved his sort of mentor character who like was teaching him how to like repair like broken antiques, refurbish. He had a great friendship with a guy named Boris. He's a Russian. Those two were troublemakers, and I loved them. I liked their wild hijinks. So it was 5 stars till halfway to the book, then just a little bit more, still 5 stars. But when Theo gets to adulthood, and like the exact moment where it started going downhill is when he's talking to this guy named Horst in a scene that really did not need to exist. We could have got the information in that scene from Boris and just saved some pages, honestly. That's when, like, things just started, like, getting too convoluted and too introspective. The main thing about this book is the painting of the Goldfinch. See it? It's really pretty. It's my screensaver now. It's the only thing that reminds Theo of his mom, of a friend he lost in the accident, and it's honestly the only thing he feels like is worth living for, the fact that he has this super valuable painting and everyone else is like on the hunt for it. He's like, I have it locked up in my storage unit. So it gives his life meaning. However, towards the end, like the last 50 pages, some stuff goes down, and then we're just sitting in a room and we're talking about the painting, and oh my gosh, how painting is such an expression of life and love, and oh, how paintings speak to us and only specific ones can call out to your soul. Ugh, it was boring. So yeah, that knocked it down. Also, there was just a lot of excessive drug use in this book, and that makes me feel sad. I got some family that deals with that, and I don't like reading that. It makes me just want to smack them upside the head, like, stop. Stop. And I'm torn whether I'm going to keep this book, because I love the half, but I'm not going to read the other half. So, chief complaint, Donna Tartt managed to be so awesome here, using a bunch of words, but making it so cohesive and so, like, natural, you don't even realize you're reading such a giant book. But now here, now we're getting, like, unnecessarily wordy about everything. Preachy. Preachy's the word. And my last book, such a long wrap-up, I need to, like, stop reading so much books. Bad books, that is. Salt to the Sea by Ruta, Sepetys. 3.5. This book is about 4 refugees, actually technically 3. One's a Nazi. 3 refugees and a Nazi who get on board the, what's it called? Wilhelm Gustloff. The most tragic maritime disaster, even above the Titanic. Many people died during World War II, and these peeps are getting on that ship. We have 4 main characters, Joanna, who is a nurse who really, really cares about others, and she's helping her little group who is traveling. There are so many countries listed in this book. I can't even begin to, like, remember who's from where, so I'm not even gonna try. They're escaping from some country ravaged by World War II, and they are headed for the ship. She meets up with Lorian, who is a German deserter, I believe, and he has some secrets he's carrying in his back. Well, his pack. His pack is on his back. The secrets aren't embedded in his back. And he's unwillingly traveling with a little girl, not little girl, see, that's another point. A girl named Amelia. She doesn't speak German really well, so she doesn't talk a lot, but we're in her head a lot, and she's really sweet. However, she's pregnant. 8 months pregnant, not a good time to be pregnant. And the thing is, she's written so innocently. She talks so naively. She has a cute pink hat. I thought she was 8 until someone says she's pregnant. And I'm like, oh, that's messed up. But then no, she's 15. I'm like, okay, I got a little concerned. And then we have Alfred. He is our Nazi. And oddly enough, he was my favorite character because people kept making a joke out of him. So whenever he came on the page, I was like, he was the butt of every joke. He was so full of himself. I am the best person on the ship. Everybody bowed at me and everybody's like, gosh. Florian gave him a hard time, like passive aggressively. And I'm like, I like this. So our four characters were interesting enough. Why I gave it a 3.5 though, it is mostly the journey to get to the ship, which, you know, did take a lot of walking. So it was a lot of talking, not like really any plot besides hiding from the armies. And I was actually fine with that. I was digging our characters, but then we get onto the ship and, you know, it's not a spoiler. The ship's gonna sink. Okay, those parts had my jaw like unhinged. I was like, oh, this is bad. Not like bad as in terrible, but like bad as in, oh, we in trouble. We need to escape. Like, I felt the tension. The 3.5 mainly came from the ending, which we had this moment of tension, then all of a sudden everything's good. We all good. Calm. Like, we were literally in the ocean, then suddenly we're on a rocker by a fireplace so and so years later. And then also, I don't want to get into spoilers for this part, but character, something happens, and we get the resolution to that character at the very end via a letter. Like, we're not with her, we get a letter. And I'm like, that's lame. The ending just wasn't that good. We had such moments of just like character building, walking and talking. You know, the suspense of outrunning Hitler. The jerk. There was one like Nazi commander who was like really giving me the chills. I'm like, ooh, you're a villain, aren't you? I was hoping we'd see more of him, but not enough. Not enough. But that ending, no, just wasn't a fan. So that's it. A pretty lame month as reading books go. However, May is already off to a smashing start. Warner, shatter me. Only 200 pages in, it has my full approval. May is bae right now, okay? And I hope you guys had like the best reading month ever. Comment down below, what's the blandest book you ever read that you can't hate because you feel like nothing happened to hate? See you guys later. Keep turning pages.